at right now, Darren?
We are somewhere deep in Virginia, ready to perform with my band. Gonna hear a little bit of go-go music. This is DC's music, originated here, and it consists of the congos, or the kungas, I would say. And that's what I play. And yeah, you're gonna hear me rock out tonight.
Here we go. Sorry, you good?
I've probably been playing the kungas longer than I've skated. As a child, I used to watch my older cousins and people like that play the kungas, and I was just so enthused with it that I started playing. And it started off with just like beating on the desk, getting pots and pans out the drawer. And what's crazy is there was a neighborhood guy who's the, you know, he's a hustler. He just happened to have a set, and we end up like kicking it. And he's like, yo, I got a set I can let you keep. And he let me keep them for months. And that was, it was over after that. Like, I really got a chance to really play every day. And ever since, I've been playing in bands. We in Savannah Terrace. This is my old neighborhood where I first started skating at. This is where I first picked up a skateboard, and we used to skate in the beginning just all around here. And as you can see, I mean, this is the trenches, man. It's been remodeled a little bit, like they fixed up the buildings a little bit, but when I grew up here, it was crazy.
What was it like?
Murder, drugs, and more murder and drugs. That's all it was. That's all it was, you know? I mean, when I grew up, it was like we didn't look up to Michael Jordan and people like that. Yeah, you know, those were the, I guess, the iconic people you would think one would idolize, but at the same time, we looked up to the drug dealers. I looked up to the people who were making money out here, the people I can come outside and really identify with. We didn't have food in the refrigerator, so to see them to have money in the cars and everything they had, that's what I looked up to. Hey, 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 working man. Yeah, man. I can't complain, yeah, man.
Man, we grew up together from...
Shit.
I'm talking about, yeah.
Elementary.
Yeah. Right here in this building. We used to live in this building. We stayed exactly right next door to each other. Skateboarding was like a white boy thing. You know what I mean? That's something that we didn't come up on skateboarding. You know what I mean? We played other games.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? I'll say other games. Listen, you can take that in other games.
Yeah, we played other games.
And down here, it was like I come out the door, I got a mask on. It's my gangster mask. It's the street mask. When I get on that bus and get downtown, I let it all out, take that mask off, I can be me, you know what I'm saying? I can really be me and let my guards down. And that was what was special about skateboarding, you know? I can be myself.
Right now we're at Freedom Plaza, AKA Pulaski Park, the mecca of skateboarding DC. So one weekend, we all just migrated down here and I was hooked. It was love at first sight for me. And I mean, it just, the scene back then was just unbelievable, you know what I'm saying? You had all the locals, Pepe Martinez, may rest in peace, Andy Stone, John Egay. After them seeing me skate consistently and come down each weekend, they started to take me in. And you know, these guys kind of became like father figures and big brothers to me, because my father was in and out of jail, so I was like a little lost kid, you know, just venturing off on a skateboard just to have fun and stay out of trouble. And this was the place that kept me out of trouble. This neighborhood is where I jumped off the porch. This is when I started selling drugs and I got into the game right here in this neighborhood. I actually used to live up the street. Now I'm saying this is where I made all my money at. This is what I would get dressed every morning like it's a job. I clock in like 8 o'clock, come out, and stand in front of these stores right here and make my money all day.
You don't feel anything?
Nah. I'm gonna be honest, if I feel a feeling, cause the hood does take you to that, it gives you an evil side. Like, it takes me to the Darren Harper, like, knowing what I'll do to somebody. Like, seriously, like, it gives me a little bit of adrenaline of what I do if somebody play with me. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, because it just takes you back to the streets. Like, you always gotta be on point, you know what I'm saying? And that's the only slight vibe I get, I'm gonna say a little bit.
Right here?
There was a phone booth right here, and I used to stash my drugs. I used to use these little, I was famous for using these little magnets, and it would have, you can put the crack, like my dimes of crack in there, and I would hide them on the magnet under the booth. So sometimes I would act like I'm going to get on the phone, and the whole time I'm slipping my crack out of the stash spots. I would come in after hard hours on the street, making all my money, I'd go in the house. And then I remember my son's mom, we was talking about what I used to do as a kid and what she used to do as a kid, and that's how skating rebirthed. She said, well, if that's what you used to do as a kid, why don't you go ahead and do it again? So I was just sitting like, you know what, that may not be a bad idea. I might could spark it back up and make something out of my life with it. And that's eventually what happened. You. Yeah, I went down to Pulaski and I started to see, I wanted to see who were the people that were still out. And they helped rekindle that as well, because I seen it was some of the good heads that I knew was still skating. So it motivated me to start come down there. But Chris was just like, yo, he just was kind of sick of it, and he wanted to save me. You know, he just felt like I was going to end up dying or something like that. So he was like, yo, I got an idea. Let's just make this video, base it around you, and get some of the heavy hitters, like our guys and homies, like Daewon Song and a couple other cats, you know, to get involved. And that's how I Get Familiar came. Man, it was one of the best experiences I ever had in my life. And after that, you know, it was kind of like, it was go time. It was like, yo, go to Cali. We was taking trips to Cali. Man, like I said, it was bonkers after that. You know, I started appearing in magazines and really like blowing up. This is really what changed my life, skateboarding. Like, it really got me out of the streets. It was a time like doing all that, like I was facing jail time. It was everything, and I said, you know what? I'm gonna put 200% into skateboarding. And Chris was right there with me, you know? It was like, let's do it. The OGs, you know, they all had a lot of pop. So that was one thing I always took a notice into even Pep, you know? Pep would do it in boots. You know what I mean? You see a fling or nolly flip, like crook on the ledge, like with these. But Reese, yeah, Joe, and it was some other guy. Oh, Sean Mullendore, them guys were like the powerhouses of pop. Like, and I used to watch them like do tricks, switch and regular, but still pop it each way. And that's what I fell in love with about skateboarding. Yeah, the big white wall came about because I used to see, you know, everybody skated. To represent DC, I feel like you gotta leave a stamp on that wall right there. You know what I'm saying? And that's how I looked at it. Like, I gotta do something crazy that to represent my city. And that's where the switch tail came about. Like, I meet people and they like, yo, or they come and they look at it and they like, yo, they stand by the wall. They're like, what the fuck? Like.
That's done.
What do you
think?
It's good.
I did Nolly backside, 180 heel, half cab heel, switch flips, switch heel, heel flip backside 180. Yeah, I love going over it. I feel like, you know, just skating that wall as a whole, that's my favorite wall to skate.
Right after, right. If you wouldn't land that. You wouldn't land that one. I was about to say, do you want it? You
no,
know what
I
mean?
No,
like,
but you know what?
Are you want it?
Back to skating, I was like, I mean, I seen what he was doing and the DGK thing came about. I was like, yo, when I seen Dirty Ghetto Kids, I was like, this is no brainer. That's me all day. It was just no brainer. It was a must. I had to be on that company. It didn't just happen like ASAP though. I do remember just like, I feel like it was like kind of a test and, you know, I had to submit footage. I had to, you know, I had to grind, you know, and then finally, you know, boom, it was it. You know, I got my first ad and the rest was history, you know? Oh man, I was excited. I felt like we was the G unit of skateboarding like that. I always say that, like, yeah, I mean, back and forth, you know, when the company's based out of LA, you have to, you know, go out there and perform and you know, you wanna be with your teammates and just the way the game works.
Oh my God, dog. Oh shit. I ain't mean to trip like that, dog. Oh my God. Thank you, God.
50-50, because I was upset, but which that's usually how it happens. You're upset at your man, and you know, it just leads to, oh, we gotta get it off our chest. And so anyhow, how I feel about the fight, like I said, it wasn't no fight. Like, I mean, me and, like, we both come from the streets, so at the same time, like, we came up slap boxing and, you know, doing whatever we had to do, you know, and a fist fight or whatever, you know, is normal. You do that and you hug your man. That's it. All right, we got a problem. Let's get this shit off our chest. And we rumble, we hug, dap up, and that's it. That's hood shit. Like, this is what it is. Them my guys, you know, for life. He my homie for life, you know, that's my brother. Like, I mean, I'm proud. I love what he doing with his kids, you know, his kids skating. You know, anytime he come to DC, he gonna pull up on me and, you know, we kick it like how we kick it. We got too much history. And I was just like, it might be time to, you know, get a job. And that's what it was. It was just like, you know, it's time to get on grown man time. You know, you can't keep sitting around and playing and then playing with your life as well. Like, I escaped the streets and then go back a little bit. It would have been a sad story if I fucking went to jail or, you know. Yeah, so I've already made the steps to start my own company. It will be called Harper Handy. It would be handyman services, residential, plumbing, HVAC, and so on. I'm excited. I can't wait. You know, I got business cards on the way. I plan to get a truck wrapped and the whole nine. That's why I always promote get a trade in my posts and things like that, just so they know if skateboarding doesn't work out, at least you have something to fall back on. Whatever it is you're trying to do, just have a plan B set up.
The cover was tapping on the fan. I should have turned it on before let you hear it, but it stopped. Like when you would first turn it on and hit the switch, it would da-da-da-da-da. It'll make this tapping sound. Stop. Gucci. Gucci bandana. That means it's gravy, it's good.
Yeah, I'm up the street though. Soon as my peoples get here, I'll be down the street. I might even skate down there because my guy, he got his board. So if my mom and everybody deep in the car, we might just skate to Pulaski. I'll let them take our luggage and stuff.
A girl dad is bonding through boarding.
That's right. Years ago, his skateboard skills turned heads in D.C. and then helped turn his life around for him. And now his lessons to his daughters are going viral.
News 4's Corey Smith caught up with all three of the skateboarding stars at Freedom Plaza.
It ain't even that many people, right? You're talking about so many people. Well, my life now these days, you know, just always skating with my kids, you know, spend a lot of time with family. You know, when I skate, again, like I'm always with them, you know, I'm coaching them as well as I skate myself.
I got my first board when I was 6 and I started learning how to push, ollieing, and then that's when I started really getting into the real stuff.
So, they coach me.
I didn't know what.
That was so good too. That was the best.
We inspire other people. Like you don't know how many like inboxes I get on Instagram just fast. Like they get a hold of my daughters like skating and they just like, yo, 3, and then I'm gonna let you go by yourself. So remember your stance. I've been looking for somebody like, can you teach lessons or can we come out with you guys? So the response of them skating is just overwhelming, man, but it's a blessing because I didn't think they would get into it, you know? I'm super proud of her for getting into skateboard, especially as a female, you know? Again, I feel like she will be the first, like, you know, female skater for Washington, D.C., you know, especially coming from the environment we come from. Like I said, man, I go to work sometimes or I always just daydream off. Like, if I can't skate, I'm always thinking about skating. And I'm thinking about what's next for them. Like, I would love to, you know, just see them progress and just take it to the next level.
Don't move. Don't tic-tac. Just stand up.
The wholesome video of a daddy-daughter day of skating has caught the attention of people around the world.
The Tony Hawk repost, you know, I mean, again, as a young kid coming from the ghetto, that's who I was looking up to.
And maybe that's what matters most here. While Darren had to search for instruction and inspiration, his daughters only have to look to their dad.